Yeah, so I think I have mentioned about the first topic that we'll be looking at. That will just be our introduction. The reason why I'm repeating this is because I realized I had not started recording. Yeah, so the first topic is introduction, which we'll be looking at the general issues about mobile programming. So for the second topic, like I said earlier, we'll be looking at the layers that are there in a mobile application. Ama, before we get from when you switch on your Android phone up the time you get that WhatsApp interface that you are seeing, what is involved? And that one we'll be looking at it in our second topic. Then for the third topic, we'll be looking at the components of the application itself. Now, take for example WhatsApp. What is involved? Because itself on your end, you only get the final package, but we need to look at it and see inside that final package what is involved. Okay, so there are so many things inside that final package that you as a developer will need to understand and be able to create when you'll be creating your mobile applications, such as such components will include activities, services, broadcast receivers, content providers. We love content providers and any other additional content. We'll be able to look at them and see what exactly is an activity, what exactly is a service, what is a broadcast receiver, and that one will be in our third topic. Then for the fourth topic, we'll be looking at introduction to Android Studio. So Android Studio is the development environment that we'll be using for this particular course. And so on our fourth topic, so basically the first three topic will all be theory, but now from the fourth topic, that when we'll be setting up our environment to start developing our applications practically. Yeah, and so I will introduce you to Android Studio, which is the best development environment so far in the market, though we will also be able to look at other alternatives. But for this for this course, we'll be settling for Android Studio. Then for our fifth topic, we'll be looking at layouts and widgets. And when you're talking about layouts, it's basically how do you lay out your application. For example, maybe you'd want your final application to include a table. So a tabular layout, a table layout, that one is only for arranging the items on your applications. So the items themselves is what we call the widgets. For example, maybe a button. You want to include a button. Maybe you want to include a text box inside your layout. Maybe you want to include an image. Those are what you call widgets.
Excuse
And
me,
that's
sir.
what we'll be looking at
Excuse me,
now.
sir.
Yes.
On Android
Yes,
Studio,
Kennedy.
on Android Studio,
Yes.
which language are we going to be
Which
using?
language are we going to be using? Okay, for the language, we'll be looking at that as we go by. Kennedy, we'll be looking at the language that we will settle for, but mostly there are two languages that we can go for. One is Java and the other one is Kotlin. Kennedy, yes.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, so I'm saying we'll be using either Java or Kotlin. For Kotlin, it's the latest language which came up around 2 or 3 years ago, but it's currently the recommended language by Google for developing mobile applications. But in our case, since you guys don't have a background in Java, we might also need to use Java at the moment for this particular unit. Is that okay, Kennedy? Yeah. Then for the sixth topic, we'll be looking at event handling. And when you talk about event handling is especially in mobile applications, every code that you'll be writing in the language that I've mentioned, that Kennedy was asking about, every code that you'll be creating in that language will be dependent for that code to be executed. It will be dependent on a user performing an action. For example, for you to send a message on WhatsApp, you must click the send button. That's right. You must click the send button. So in that case, there is some code underlying which you are calling an event handler that will be determining when a user clicks on this button, what happens. or when I use, for example, when you are searching for your contacts, when I start typing, I want some code to run in the background and look through my contacts and suggest depending on what I have already typed. So all of that we'll be looking at it under topic 6, which is event handling. Then for topic 7, we'll be yes, Brian.
Why do you have to learn?
Brian?
I am asking.
Okay, thank you for that, Brian. The reason why I settled for Android Studio is, remember, the major creator of the Android operating system is Google. So we usually most rely on Google for Android updates. And currently, they recommend Android Studio as the best IDE. But also, we will be looking at other IDEs that you can use as an option. So it's not a must to use Android Studio. The only thing I'm saying here is for my instructions, for directions, I will be using Android Studio in my case, but you can also suggest other IDEs that we can use, other development environments that we can use, and maybe we can settle for the best. So I have no problem switching from Android Studio, but like I've advised, the best IDE currently is Android Studio.
So I have a question.
Yes.
You said you'll be studying about Android, right? So what about operating systems such as iOS?
Yeah, okay, I understand. We have other operating systems. We have very many mobile operating systems in the market, such as we have iOS, that is iPhone operating system by Apple. We have Symbian by Nokia. We also have Windows by Microsoft and others. But also we'll be looking at, in our first topic, we'll be trying to analyze and compare those different mobile phone operating systems. And I'll give you we'll come up with enough reasons to show why I settled for Android Studio. But the major reason is the Android Studio has the largest market share among all those mobile operating systems. So that's the only major reason. Android has the biggest market share. And I think all of you can bear witness, because I'm not sure. In this particular class, how many of you are using iOS? Anyone using iOS in the class? So I'm quite sure you can bear me witness, not so many people are using iOS, but that doesn't mean it's inferior. Another thing you need to know about iOS is because iOS is closed. Okay, it's not open source as compared to Android. iOS is licensed by Apple, and so there is so much restriction when it comes to developing those particular applications. I don't mean to say that you can't develop iOS applications, but there are some restrictions. But also, I will be considering introducing you to how you can be able to make your application cross-platform, such that you create it only once, and it can be able to run on both iOS and Android. So I hope that is clear. So for the seventh topic, we'll be looking at themes and styles. So you'll see how we can apply different themes to our applications. We'll see what a theme is and the different styling that you can be able to make our final product look appealing and usable to the end user. Then for the eighth topic, we'll be looking at menu and preferences. We'll be seeing how we can be able to set menus. We'll also be able to see the menu features and others. Then for the last topic, we'll be looking at advanced mobile programming concepts. So in this case, we'll be looking how to set up a database, how to set up services and notifications, how to set up broadcast receivers. In this case, when I talk about databases, mostly we'll be using SQLite databases for mobile applications. The reason I use SQLite is because you'll discover that a big database system such as MySQL, they are quite huge, and they can't, when it comes to mobile applications have that challenge of constrained resources. You have that challenge of constrained resources, that is in terms of memory, but you'll find that SQLite is so small, so it can easily work with your mobile application, especially when you're considering storing offline data. Not in the situation of applications like WhatsApp, which maybe require to connect to a server or something. But for application that we'll be creating that you need to store offline data, SQLite will be the best option. So for the teaching methodology, we'll be doing discussions once in a while. I'll be allowing students to discuss on a certain topic via the ZDS platform. Presentations. Also, I need to give you some assignments that maybe you can present to your peers. We'll also be giving you assignments, case studies, essays, and the others. Then for instructional materials, we'll use a projector. So in this case, in place of a projector, we have a screen sharing. We have screen sharing in the case of the online learning. We have screen sharing. Also in the case of online learning, we also have a whiteboard. I'll be able to show you later. I love a whiteboard that I can be able to write something and you can be able to see on your end. Unfortunately, we not have computer labs, so I'll expect everyone for this online session, I'll expect everyone to at least have a personal computer. It's quite unfortunate for mobile applications. I don't think there is a platform that you can use on a phone to create Android applications. So maybe I will need you to get a good computer. And what I mean by a good computer, you need to look at a software requirement, or I mean a requirement specification of Android Studio. And then, like I mentioned earlier, we'll be using Android Studio as our development environment. Assessment criteria is not any different from the other units that you have been doing. But since we are talking about abnormal times, for the assignments, they might not be two, because it's a requirement that you do an activity at the end of every session. So all those activities that you have done before the end of the course, they'll account for 40% of your final grade. So make sure you always look out at the end of every session, look out if I've given any assignment or an activity that you are required to participate. Then for attendance, there must be 80% attendance for total classes, even for the online platform. I'll be creating a register that you'll also be able to view. So every time you attend a class, I'll be able to mark the register to show that you attended our live session. Yeah, and then you'll do your final examination, which is yet to be determined how you'll do it, but we'll be hoping that as soon as things settle, we'll be able to come back to the institution and do a sitting exam. Then for the resources,
I have a question.
Yes, Brian.
What are the specs for minimum?
So for Android Studio, the minimum requirement, maybe for the two ones I can look at, which are major, is the RAM and the base frequency, the clock speed of your processor. For the RAM, it must be at least 4 GB, but it's recommended to be 8 GB. 8 GB is recommended. Then for base frequency on the processor, it must be at least 2.6 gigahertz. That is the base frequency. Eh? So that was the turbo. The turbo, for those who have the processors with turbo boost, the turbo boost doesn't count. So you'll be looking at the base frequency. So for those who are looking to acquiring new machines, make sure at least it has a base frequency of at least 2.6 gigahertz and 8 GB RAM. If you already have a machine which has maybe 4 GB RAM, you can consider maybe upgrading. Because in this case, I'm assuming after running this course, this will not be the end. You'll also continue developing applications for your own personal projects. So it's better if you can be able to invest on a good machine, well and good.
Another question.
Yes.
When you submit the executable, or the entire file folder.
Okay, yeah, so you'll come to learn that when I'll be giving you maybe some activities to do, maybe I want you to create an application, you'll find that the app usually contain so many files. Okay, and so submitting maybe those files individually might be a bit challenging for you. But I think all of you know we have so many code hosting applications, and one of them is GitHub. GitHub can be, you can be able to host your code there. And maybe if you would like, we can start maybe by showing you the basic commands for using Git or for using GitHub, such that if when you create your application, you can be able to easily push your code to GitHub, and then you only share with me the link so that I can be able to view your code. But the only thing I need you to assure you is that Android applications, they require a lot of your commitment. If all of you are really want to come out with skills, because those keys are what matters a lot when you come out here, I will need a lot to invest you to invest some time to be able to grasp the concepts of this particular course. Brian, so you look at GitHub. You can maybe research on GitHub if you're not already aware of it. You can try to see how it works, or any other Git hosting service. So you can, but I recommend GitHub. So just go to Google, type GitHub, and try to see how it works. So that will be the best way for you to submit the practical assignments that I'll be giving you. Is that okay, Brian? Yeah. For the reference, there is a book called The BC Coder's Guide to Android Development. You can access it. You can buy it from this link. But alternatively, I'll be sharing with you. I'll be uploading the book on our portal for this unit. It gives you a very detailed description on how you can create the applications. So for those who are very enthusiastic about this particular field of programming, I would want to urge you to consider downloading the book and at least look ahead before we get to that topic, go through it. And then for also Google has a website for guiding the developers. So you can go to your browser and type developer.android.com. You'll find guides or tutorials from even a beginner to an expert. You'll be able to find tutorials for both Java and even Kotlin, like I mentioned earlier. I hope we are all okay with the course outline. Maybe if you have a question that you didn't understand, you can ask. So for someone who was asking about constrained resources, what I mean by constrained resources is I mean they are few. For example, you can't compare a computer with your phone in terms of storage. You find that your phone has only 16 GB while your computer has even 2 TB or 1 TB of storage. Okay. You'll find that the processor that is in your machine is at 2.6 gigahertz, while the mobile phone has only maybe 1.8, even some goes even below one. So that's what I meant by constrained resources. Someone else maybe with a question? So as we try to think of maybe the questions to ask concerning the course outline or what to expect on this course, maybe we can do a brief introduction on topic one.
Excuse me, can we merge on
Nini? Can we merge on Nini?
On what?
When can we help each other?
Can we help each other? We are calling
for. So when he has a problem, I can submit it to the branch.
Sorry?
Can I merge someone else's branch?
Are you referring to GitHub?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, and that one, of course, when you come to GitHub, there is the issue of branches, and we usually use branches a lot. And for those maybe who are looking to learn about GitHub, you also need to understand how branches work. And like, you know, branches are always used to, because you usually have one branch that is usually created by Devote when you create a Git project, which we call it master, and it's considered that's a stable code that you have currently. Yes, but for experimental purposes, you always create a new branch. When you create a new branch for experimental purposes, you test that branch first, and as soon as you are sure that it's okay, then you merge it with your master branch. But now in the case that you're working as a group, every member of that group must create his own branch, and now the leader is the one who is supposed to maintain the master branch, but the other members can have their own branches. Then as soon as they are satisfied that the whatever they have in their branch is good enough, then they can send it to the supervisor so that you can merge it with the master branch. Hope I have answered your question, Kennedy.
Yes.
Mwalimu.
Yes.
Mtu anaweza upgrade processor.
Yeah, I've seen that question there. I was about to respond to it. And upgrading processor, especially for a laptop, is not possible because usually the processor is bound on the motherboard, like eco-soldered for motherboard. Okay. So if you were to upgrade the processor, maybe you change the whole board. You change the whole motherboard. But for desktops, it's very easy to upgrade the processor.
That's the only risk.
The only risk.
For changing the whole motherboard for a processor, okay, it's not risky at all, changing the whole motherboard, but it will be expensive.
Oh, so.
Yeah.
But you can always do a trading. Some vendors do, they allow trading where you can add some more money to get a more upgraded laptop. That is in, if you are thinking it in that direction.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I can see someone complaining of echoes. So that's why I think most of you, this is not your first session. Like we had said, you should always mute your microphone unless you're the one speaking to avoid the echoes, but I hope I'm audible enough. Anyone else with a question? And something else I would like to maybe encourage you about these live sessions. They are almost similar to the classroom sessions. So I would encourage you always to come with your notebooks, write notes. I know there is a recording that you receive after this, but you know you can't keep watching videos. Eh? You need to, there is a time for everything. So if it's time for class, make sure you utilize those 3 hours well. So come with your notebook. As I take you through the certain concepts, note down some of the things. So don't wait to watch the video because that will be doing like double work. Be noting the most important concepts as I take you through. So I think if there is no other question, I would like to introduce, to do a little bit of introduction. That is on our first topic. So the unit is called the mobile applications, but mostly, like we said, we'll be settling for Android development. And we are going to start by looking at mobile phone evolution. Eh? So the phone that you are currently enjoying dates back from 18, is a product of work that started in 1876 by this guy called Graham Bell, who was the first guy to receive a patent for electric phone. I think the guy is pictured on the side here. Yeah. It is in 1876, that quite many years ago. And then in 1936, this guy called Alfred Gross, at least is the first guy now to come up with something close to a mobile phone, something that is can move, such as a walkie-talkie, and what have you. 1975, that's when the first now phone, mobile phone came into place by this guy called Martin Cooper, a Motorola radio phone. Maybe most of you, okay, not most of you, I think a few of you, eh? Those who are close to my age, were able maybe to see one of these phones, which had an aerial, okay? That was from 1975, but then in 2007, eh? I know most of you are not aware of that. 2007, that's when we had the first smartphone. And that first smartphone was created by Apple. Apple was the first company to create a smartphone. That is iPhone. I think it was iPhone 1. It was iPhone 1. And it happened that time. So many people are even scrambling for the phones. Okay. Yeah. So that's the first smartphone that we had. But later, the same year, Google were able to come up with an Android phone. That is the Google Pixels. Yeah. So basically, nowadays, the phone that we are using, you can see it's a combination of the cellular phone, some semiconductors, and also a computer. And then this one just shows how the cell phone frequencies works. The reason why it's called a cell phone is because we usually have a base stations organized in form of cells, where we have one station broadcasting only within the cell. That's why you'll be able to see there are boosters in most of the places that you are living. There is always a booster close to you to be able to power that particular cell division. Then the software, now the Android software, it's an open source. It's Linux based. It's a Linux based operating system for those who are aware about Linux. Yeah, you know, Linux was initiated by one guy, but nowadays it's being the development is being continued by more than 1,000 developers across the globe. So Android on that Linux AMA, that very noble operating system. So for Android, it's being developed by a group of people, a group of companies we call Open Handset Alliance. Okay, Open Handset Alliance is is a group of more than 80 companies, mostly telecommunication companies or software development companies that we'll be looking at. So, and the operating system has a support for a lot of things, including making a call, sending emails, messages, contacts, calendar, and the other things. Then we also have third-party Java developers who can use Android API to extend the functionality of the devices. So at the start, we'll be able to develop your application here without even invoking any other language. But for it to be able to do some of the functionality, you need to invoke the use of Java. And then we have said that Google also provides a market. You're already aware of it. You have the Play Store, where you can be able to maybe publish your mobile app that you have created, or you can be able to buy an application from other developers. So what is Android? You can be able to view a video. There are some links that I have shared in those notes. I'll be uploading the notes for YouTube videos. You can always take time to go to look at them. So these are the companies which make up the Open Handset Alliance. So we have operators such as China Mobile, China Telecommunication, T-Mobile, SoftBank. We have software companies such as Google, Kaipop, and the others. We have a commercialization institution. We have semiconductor companies such as ARM, Broadcom, which they bring you some devices such as the wireless adapter. I think you all know Broadcom for creating wireless adapters so that your phone can be able to connect to Wi-Fi. We also have handset manufacturers. I'm a phone manufacturer such as Dell, Acer, HTC, Samsung, and what have you. So the Android operating system is not a one-man job. It's being supported by so many companies, as you can see from your screens. So you can also be able to view this video on YouTube. Then mobile revolution. So not so long ago, somebody said that you needed to have a phone. Mm-hmm. You also needed to have a laptop with you. Kuna wale lazima you had to have those iPods. iPods for listening to music. Others and maybe PS or something, game pads. But nowadays, you don't need all those. Okay. With your mobile phone, you can be able to do almost everything that those can do. In your phone, you have a music player, can be able to send an email, can be able to play video games and what have you. So today, now we only have smartphones and laptops. It has replaced all of those. Okay. But also, you can even do without your laptop. You can use your smartphone completely for your day-to-day issues, because I don't think there is something you can't do without your smartphone. Now, of course, unless you bring in the issue of developers, for developers, you'll need a laptop. So that's how things have evolved. So nowadays with your phone, or maybe with your phone, you can be able to access all these services. Okay. Yeah, you can be able to send money, can be able